finding out.
Palace. History has happened here before, and tonight it will happen again, with a glittering gala at which you will be a guest. We welcome many honored guests for this occasion. To some, of course, the venue is familiar. They have been here before. They know their way up the stairs. And to some, it's almost a second home. There are celebrities from the world of diplomacy, from the world of the arts, and, of course, from the world of entertainment. Top businessmen. Social workers. Leaders from underdeveloped nations. And some who are just ordinary taxpayers. Yes, they've all come to join an audience of millions across the world for this Night of Nights. Ladies and gentlemen, your host for this evening, Mr. Clive James.
Welcome to Buckingham Palace. Yes, tonight Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II has generously made the palace available to us for this broadcast, which will be received not just in Britain, but in Australia, New Zealand, the United States, and the rest of the British Empire. We offer the Queen our loyal thanks, and a cross check payable to the H.M. Windsor Corporation of the Bahamas is in the post. Later on, we will be announcing our prestigious annual awards for achievement in various categories, culminating in our world-famous Man or Woman of the Year award. And to help me do that, I'll be joined by the very wonderful Louise Lombard. Meanwhile, what better place than these historic surroundings in which to review an historic year, 1993, a year of events so confusing that only after we have analyzed them tonight will you realize just how confusing it all was. When the year began, there was only one thing you could say for certain. It was January. The eyes of the world were on Washington for the inauguration of a new president of the United States. At the inauguration parade, the British contribution especially impressed the president and Mrs. Clinton. The band of the Coldstream Guards had added one or two discreet touches just for America. President Clinton had the invaluable assistance of his wife, Hillary, who was always at his side to tell him what to do next. "Don't do anything until I tell you to," she whispered. "And while you're waiting for me to tell you what to do, don't sit around with your mouth open." But President Clinton didn't always find this advice easy to follow. Everyone had forgotten that George Bush used to be president, including George Bush, who thought he still was. He surprised the Russians by turning up unexpectedly in Moscow. Mr. Yeltsin received Mr. Bush politely, but had a pressing schedule. The Princess of Wales, ever mindful of her duties as a member of the royal family, took off on a punishing tour of the Caribbean. She told reporters, "Really, I'd rather be waist-deep in scratchy old Scottish heather watching my husband and father-in-law shooting everything that moves. But someone's got to do this." In Britain, the Church of England was moving closer to admitting women priests. In Rome, the Pope said the Catholic Church would never allow anything so sinful.
In atto nei Balcani costituisce un particolare accumulo di peccati. Esseri umani usano strumenti di istruzione.
British Prime Minister John Major was in the Middle East pursuing his policy that leaders of underdeveloped nations with primitive legal systems should visit Saudi Arabia as often as possible. Mr. Major impressed the Saudi leaders with his tough talk.
"Extremely nice to be back."
Yeah. The highlight of Mr. Major's visit was a meeting with King Fahd's brothers-in-law. Only a few of King Fahd's brothers-in-law could be present for the official reception, but once again, Mr. Major left a strong impression with his dynamism.
What do you mean? Nice to see you again, Howard.
One brother-in-law said afterwards, I preferred Mrs. Thatcher. She shook hands like a man. The visit ended with the offering of traditional Islamic hospitality. This is a nice cup of weak tea, said Mr. Major. Yours is, said the king. Mine's a drambuie. Sport. And in Italy, British soccer star Paul Gazza Gascoigne impressed the Italians with his quick mastery of the Italian language. After a visit to a high-class restaurant, he proved he had already learnt the Italian word for delicious. Nice one, Gazza. The film of the month was Bram Stoker's Dracula, a story of an elderly vampire played by a former rock star in heavy makeup. Can you guess who?
God, who are you? I know you.
I have crossed oceans of time to find you.
Who was this old man about to sink his fangs into the neck of an innocent young girl? Yes, it was Bill Wyman. More than ever in 1993, it was important not to let the news get you down. The remedy was to stay in touch with the child within yourself, especially if there was another child out in the streets stealing your car. The only answer, as the Bluebells told us, was to be young at heart. February, and in Downing Street, British Prime Minister John Major's prestige was slipping. At a reception for the President of the Ukraine, Mr. Major discovered that high-ranking members of his own party would not only avoid shaking his hand, but would actually indicate their deep contempt. Prince Charles and the Queen Mother paid their annual visit to the Royal College of Music, which was unfortunately scheduled for the same day as a horse race meeting at Newmarket.
As the eighth director of the college,
Prince Charles listened with close attention to the three-hour welcoming speech while the Queen Mother got on with studying her race card. Don't worry about me being bored stiff, she told Charles. I've been putting up with this sort of thing for 90 years. Between Britain and the USA, the special relationship of mutual respect had never been more strong. In Washington, President Clinton put on a hard hat and made a special visit to the British Embassy. It was being expensively refurbished in order to reduce costs. The British ambassador met him at the gate with all the pride and dignity of a representative of a great power. The English cricket team, on tour in India, said they would have won if the local food hadn't been poisoned, the other side hadn't cheated, the sun hadn't been in their eyes, and if the planet Mercury hadn't been in the cusp of Taurus. But it was clear that the England team's poor performance had nothing to do with lack of preparation. The batsmen were in the gymnasium every morning, practicing how to get back to the pavilion as quickly as possible. English cricket was in the doldrums, and the selectors decided it needed an injection of American glamour. Unfortunately, film star Kevin Costner turned down the invitation to keep wicket for England.
I make movies. That's really all I do. I don't, you know, go out and stump for for people.
The Maastricht Treaty was the most complicated political issue ever to face the British public, and nobody really understood it until Lady Thatcher explained it with meticulous clarity.
To express your views, either that you are for, in which case you vote for this number, is the one at the for Maastricht, in which case you vote 335501. If you are against, then 5502.
Got it now? The war between British Airways and Virgin Airways hit the headlines again. It was a war that Virgin looked like winning. The deciding factor was the quality of Virgin's in-flight service, personally supervised by Virgin boss Richard Branson. Each male passenger will be waited on hand and foot and other areas of interest. Lord King was asked what British Airways could offer a woman passenger.
Nothing.
In an attempt to offset the British Prime Minister's sliding popularity, Mr. Major was advised to liven up his press conferences by making unexpected moves. At his latest press conference, an advisor whispered to him that according to the agreed timetable, the moment had come for him to make his unexpected move. For the first time, Her Majesty the Queen was made liable for income tax, whereupon it was discovered that she had less money than a famous pop star. Commentators said this was unfair because she sang so much better than he did. The proposed world boxing heavyweight title fight between the Pope and Nelson Mandela had attracted the attention of sports fans all over the world. At the weigh-in, Mr. Mandela said, "The Pope's got some powerful men in his corner, including God." The Pope said, "I'll moider the bum." Sir Ranulph Twisleton Wickham Fiennes and his partner, the Mayor Mike Stroud, made a successful expedition to the South Pole. Unfortunately, Sir Ranulph's nose didn't make it. Television hit of the month was a brave and realistic miniseries about the marriage crisis of the Prince and Princess of Wales called Diana, Her True Story. It was a classic study of identity. It was clear that the actress wearing the Sony Walkman was meant to be the Princess of Wales, but who was the bag lady she met at the foot of the stairs?
Good afternoon, Diana. How are you?
February's sensational musical breakthrough was the discovery of a fabulous new Australian teenage rap star.
There's a lady in the show, all that glitters is gold, and she's buying the stairs.
Rolf Harris told the musical press, "I know I'm very young for all this success, but I also realize that getting the first hit is easy. It's the next 40 years on the road that count, and I think I'm ready." Time now to start the majestic process which will ultimately lead to the conferring of our celebrated award for Man or Woman of the Year. This year we are following John Major's guidelines, which require a truly meritocratic honour system to produce a classless society in conformity with the Citizens' Charter. To help me understand what on earth John Major is talking about, we've brought in a brilliant young actress who also happens to be an expert in complex statistical analysis. Fresh from the House of Elliot, would you please welcome Louise Lombard. Louise, welcome. You've studied our new system. How does it work?
Well, Clive, we've installed a giant BBC computer here in Buckingham Palace in what used to be the Princess of Wales' dressing room and ensuite discotheque. And that computer has spent months sorting out all the nominees for Man or Woman of the Year into various categories, so that if someone loses in one category, they can win in another.
Could you be a little clearer?
Well, let me put it this way. You could come second in the first category, or third in the second category, or even fourth in the third category, but as long as you come first in the fourth category, you can go on to come first, second, or third in the final category.
Now I get it. Okay, Louise, what's our first category tonight?
This is the category for continuous success. And it's for those people who have shown that when they stumble, they just pick themselves up and keep going, even though their loved ones, and indeed everyone else, beg them to stop.
And the nominees?
The first nominee is England soccer manager Graham Taylor.
Another manager would have resigned at the first defeat. He waited until the 50th.
The second nominee is ex-Chancellor Norman Lamont.
Another minister would have resigned when wise men told him to. He waited until John Major told him to.
The third nominee is Frank Bruno.
Another boxer with his ability would have lain down before he got hit. He waited until afterwards.
The fourth nominee is Lady Thatcher.
Another deposed leader would have gone with grace and dignity. She didn't go. And the winner, Louise?
The winner of the Category 4 Continuous Success is Graham Taylor.
Sadly, Graham can't be with us tonight, but he's just heard the news of his success, and we're going over live to him now. Graham, what would it mean if you became our Man of the Year?
I would think it would mean suddenly I'm the best thing that's ever happened to English football, according to people.
Thank you, Graham Taylor. And Graham's name now goes forward into the final selection for Man or Woman of the Year. More categories later, but for now, it's back to you, Clive, and on with the show.
March. And Britain's Prime Minister, John Major, had an image problem. It was being suggested that he lacked the power of decision. But at a press conference for top women reporters at Downing Street, he proved he could tackle the big decisions without hesitation.
Tea or coffee? Tea. Four teas and one coffee.
There was huge embarrassment for the Hoover vacuum cleaner company when they offered a free holiday anywhere to anyone who bought a vacuum cleaner. The result? Too many people bought vacuum cleaners. Soon there were more vacuum cleaners than there was dust available to be vacuumed. People who bought their vacuum cleaners early did get their holidays. Hoover holidaymaker P. Ashdown got a luxury cruise. The deck games were quite fun, he said. I enjoyed playing shufflefish. But fish quoits was a bit too tricky for me. French Hoover buyer and professional ladies' man, Monsieur F. Mitterrand, didn't get the holiday he wanted.
Je souhaite qu'il soit en mesure de former une équipe gouvernementale solide et cohérente dans les plus brefs délais.
The Hoover holiday applicants who were hit the hardest were those who not only didn't get a holiday, but also complained that their vacuum cleaners didn't work.
There is no vacuum.
One American senior citizen said that for an older person, the vacuum cleaner was simply too heavy.
It's a heavy sucker, I gotta tell you that.
In 1993, popular music held little of interest for anyone interested in music, so the golden oldies were sounding better than ever, and some of them were looking that way too. Diana Ross celebrated her 30 years in show business with a video that revitalized all those doting males who now had arthritis in the fingers they once snapped to the Motown beat. Italy. And after a series of crises, the Italian Parliament was back to normal. A bill for the compulsory disclosure of members' interests in young female film stars went smoothly through the House, with hardly anyone getting shot. Russian President Boris Yeltsin was in conflict with his own government. At the root of the conflict was the economic situation. But President Yeltsin was able to report a dramatic economic upswing when Russian scientists finally managed to duplicate Coca-Cola. He told the Presidium, "Our Coca-Cola is even better. Theirs is a dirty brown color, whereas ours is an attractive shade of green because of the battery acid." Rolling Stone Bill Wyman's son announced that he was going to marry the mother of his father's ex-wife. At the engagement party, Bill Wyman shook hands with himself, crying, "Hello, uncle." The problem of how to reduce Russia's huge armed forces was solved by the Russian army itself with a new training program. Inside a week, the army was down to 6 men in bandages. April, and in Washington, Hillary Clinton scheduled an important meeting between President Clinton and Prime Minister Miyazawa of Japan. But President Clinton was disappointed when there was no sign of the Japanese Prime Minister. President Clinton said, "I'm just sorry that Prime Minister Miyazawa couldn't be here." "I am here," said Mr. Miyazawa. "Oh, there you are down there," said President Clinton. The two leaders went off to find something for Mr. Miyazawa to stand on. In Britain, the transporting of prisoners from court to jail was privatized. The security company Group 4 took over, and there was an immediate improvement. The improvement was for the prisoners. But Group 4 were not about to lose their heads. They were about to lose some more prisoners. Group 4 conducted an intensive review of procedure. The prisoners followed the usual procedure. President Yeltsin of Russia swore in his new cabinet after swearing out the old cabinet he had just sworn at. He shook hands with the Minister of Food, the Minister of No Food, the Minister of No Milk Either, the Minister of Plastic Shoes, the Minister of Paper Socks, and an old drinking friend just back from the People's Drying Out Clinic. In Washington, at a gathering on the White House lawn, President Clinton had a warm encounter with a guest he did not realize had been invited. It was Prime Minister Miyazawa of Japan. Italy, and the previous month's calm debate in the Italian Parliament continued. The final vote was ayes 360, noes 239, ears 48, teeth 846, and one unidentified portion of groin. The country was rocked when football manager Brian Clough, having drunk deep from the well of fame, at last staggered into the twilight. Many felt that this was yet another case of a leader betrayed. And no one expressed this more clearly than Nottingham Forest's own Queen of the Cop.
"That man showed leadership, who showed real feeling."
Mr. Clough said afterwards, "Whatever you do, don't give that woman my address." Walt Disney's delightful Jungle Book was finally released on video, and soon we were all laughing at the comic capers of those wonderful furry and scaly creatures as they went through their almost human routines. May, and another crisis for the British royal family. It was finally proved what had long been suspected. They were all being bugged by MI5. A private conversation between the Queen and her assistant money counter in waiting was picked up at a distance by an MI5 directional microphone and revealed to be a scathing condemnation of the Prime Minister. "He's such a wet fish," the Queen said. "You feel like getting hold of his nose and doing this with it." The younger royals took measures to counter the bugging. Princess Anne sent a written message to the Duke of York. The message read, "Whole family being bugged. I am watching you through binoculars. If you understand, raise your head and make a silly face." When Anne and Andrew next met, they muttered harmless pleasantries, but by using an elaborate code of hand signals, they actually discussed what happened when Fergie broke into Andrew's Buckingham Palace flat while he was out. She came over the wall, down the corridor, raided the gas meter, and she was gone. Michael Jackson was the guest speaker at the World Convention of Plastic Surgeons in Geneva. The 1,200 plastic surgeon delegates, who had all operated on Mr. Jackson, gave him a big hand. But they said they would make it smaller next time he came in for an overhaul. Politics, and as the forthcoming economic recovery plunged Britain into ever-deepening crisis, it was time for Mr. Major to put the country before his personal friendship and profound professional respect for the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Mr. Norman Lamont. Obliged to sign the order that would remove Mr. Lamont from office, Prime Minister Major fought to control his tears of pain and grief at the bitterness of the moment. America and President Clinton was under attack for displaying poor judgment. A whole airport came to a halt while he had his hair cut. But Mr. Clinton soon disarmed criticisms of extravagance by adopting a more modest attitude to his personal security. The previously conspicuous Secret Service personnel were replaced by a low-profile camouflage squad who blended invisibly into the surroundings. President Clinton was able to rebut critics who said he was not communicating sufficiently with Vice President Al Gore. Mr. Clinton proved that he was in constant telephonic communication with Mr. Gore, however far apart they might happen to be. The film of the month was Indecent Proposal. It was a fantasy about a woman who, when offered a chance to go to bed with Robert Redford plus $1 million thrown in, took longer than 5 seconds to make up her mind.
Suppose I were to offer you $1 million for one night with your wife. Now, the evening would come and go, but the money could last a lifetime. $1 million.
People who saw the film were interviewed by this program and asked how much they'd charge to sleep with Robert Redford.
£565 million.
Sorry, mate. It's £1.4 billion.
I don't think very much.
England's entry for this year's Eurovision Song Contest was in the talented hands of Sonia.
Baby, don't do things that make me cry. I just can't sing to sleep at night. You know I love him every day. Breaks my heart, but he goes away. Devil, you know him.
In the contest, England's entry came second, just ahead of the French entry, Frankie Mitterrand singing Bonk Bonk a Bonk. Time for another category in our selection of Man or Woman of the Year for 1993. Which category is this, Louise?
Well, Clive, this is the category for self-assertion, and it's for all those people who are basically shy by nature, yet who bravely repress their shyness until it entirely disappears.
And the nominees?
The first nominee is Michael Winner.
Beneath that brash, vulgar, argumentative exterior is a man who wanted to be a Trappist monk, but he failed the physical.
The second nominee is Gary Glitter.
Beneath that brash, noisy, extravagant exterior is a man who wanted to be Vera Lynn, but he was too old.
The third nominee is Madonna.
Beneath that brash, erotic, arrogant exterior is a woman who wanted to be Arnold Schwarzenegger, but he didn't want to be her.
And the fourth nominee is Lady Thatcher.
Beneath that brash, vindictive, domineering exterior is a woman who is brash, vindictive, and domineering. And the winner?
The winner of the category for self-assertion is Lady Thatcher.
Sadly, Lady Thatcher can't be with us tonight, but she's just been told the good news, so let's go over live to find out how she feels about her chances in the final.
It looks hopeful, so I'm quite optimistic.
Just quite optimistic?
That quite optimistic. It's hopeful.
She's hopeful, Clive. Thank you, Lady Thatcher. And Lady Thatcher's name now goes forward into the final selection for our Man or Woman of the Year. More categories later, but for now, it's back to you, Clive, and on with the show.
June, and senior citizens in the Westminster district of London were experiencing increasing trouble in crossing the road owing to traffic congestion. One bus pass holder said, "If I don't get across soon, I'll miss the 2:30 at Newmarket." Britain's Foreign Secretary, Mr. Douglas Hurd, was emerging as the most stony-faced of all international statesmen. At a government reception, Mr. Hurd betrayed no sign of distress when a foreign diplomat broke wind. Pop single of the month came from the Pet Shop Boys. It was called "Can You Forgive Her?" It featured three women dancers who were taught the rudiments of cricket to make the video. The three women later went on to beat the England Test team by 6 wickets. Elizabeth Taylor's pet dog bit her husband, Larry Fortensky. Miss Taylor reluctantly took the only course open to her. "I hated having Larry put to sleep," she said, "but I have to protect the ones I love." In Russia, President Boris Yeltsin increased his stature with a visit to the Moscow McDonald's. He was there to prove that he was a man who knew how to give orders. He was the first customer to order the new Moscow equivalent of the Big Mac, the Big Boris, the 5% meat hamburger, consumed within 10 minutes of purchase or face the consequences. The Big Boris hamburger was exported to McDonald's in America, where it underwent extensive trials at a McDonald's branch near the White House. One customer thought that half a dozen Big Borises made a nice mid-afternoon snack with a bit left over for the evening. Paris, and there was a setback for ladies' man President Mitterrand when his chief of secret liaisons, Le chef de banquine clandestine, told the president why it had been impossible to arrange a meeting with Michelle Pfeiffer. She says, "You're a fat old frog, Monsieur President." Prince Charles continued to be plagued by the media concentration on his estranged wife. At a polo match, he had just scored his 5th goal in the 3rd chukka by leaning down from the saddle and striking the ball with his nose while juggling 3 oranges and reciting Kipling's If. He was then told that the cameras had arrived just too late. Sex and the alliance between tennis star Andre Agassi and Hollywood star Barbara Streisand grasped the imagination of the world. On court, Andre Agassi proudly bared his chest for his admirers. One admirer said, "You call that a chest? Take a look at this." 1993 was the year when people finally became humble enough to accept their own conceit. President Clinton's haircut set the theme. It said that to be preposterously pompadoured was to be perfectly normal. As the pop group Culture Beat explained, what was once a vice was now a virtue. And what was that virtue's name?
Vanity, vanity, all is vanity.
July, and world leaders met for an economic summit in Tokyo. Miniature Japanese Prime Minister Mr. Miyazawa had his usual problems communicating with President Clinton, so they chatted happily about two entirely different subjects. Mr. Miyazawa had an even bigger problem with Russia's President Yeltsin. Mr. Miyazawa had the same problem with all the leaders until President Mitterrand showed up. Highlight of the Japanese summit was the combined state dinner and world chopsticks competition. President Clinton, technical merit 5.4, artistic impression 5.8. President Mitterrand, technical merit 5.5, artistic impression 5.7, appreciation of waitress 5.9. But the gold medal went to Britain's John Major, who scored two perfect sixes with a dazzling free program. After a stunning opening sequence, he sustained a difficult cross-chopstick lift for 2 minutes. Watching Japanese chopstick masters named him Hashi Sensei, meaning the exciting one. When the summit broke up, new friends among the world leaders had to say goodbye. President Mitterrand went home early, so Prime Minister Miyazawa had no one to talk to. Next time I'll invite King Hussein of Jordan, he commented. Chancellor Kohl of Germany gave President Yeltsin of Russia a parting gift. President Yeltsin had previously worn a Russian watch. Chancellor Kohl had given him a German one. "I can sell this for 10 American dollars, Mr. Yeltsin." Back in London, Prime Minister Major was attracting headlines. Some of the headlines were critical. Others were vicious. How did Mr. Major cope with this constant criticism? Luckily, he was able to take refuge late at night in his love for music and literature. Searching through his serious music collection, he was unable to find his favorite, Cliff Richard Swings the Classics, so he settled for his second favorite. And then came the moment for yet another attempt to get past page 3 of A Brief History of Time. In Paris, John Major and Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd met President Mitterrand and his colleagues. Mr. Major saw the prestigious meeting as an opportunity to strengthen his position. "How long do you give him?" asked Mr. Mitterrand. 3 weeks max," said Mr. Hurd loyally. "Don't call me Max," said Mr. Mitterrand. The British Labour Party, having been defeated in every election since the Battle of Hastings, the pressure was on its leader, John Smith, to come up with a solution. After several weeks of intensive thought, he finally produced a revolutionary technique for a Labour Party victory.
"I want people to vote Labour."
This month's royal wedding of the year was between Count Jean-François de Chambrun, one of the countless counts of France, and Rayne Spencer, daughter of prolific novelist and marriage guidance expert Barbara Cartland. The marriage began to go wrong when Rayne whispered to her bridegroom, "I've got a surprise for you. Mummy's coming to live with us." In a bid to maximize Bill Clinton's international appeal, Hillary Clinton instructed him to adopt Hawaiian national dress for a visit to Honolulu. He was greeted with the traditional Hawaiian native chant, "Here comes another schmuck wearing a salad." For his visit to Hawaii, President Clinton took his wife Hillary along to help him receive Hawaii's traditional gift to a visiting American president. It was a handcrafted Hawaiian vomit bowl. "We really need one of those," said the president. "Thanks very much." "It's just awful," said Hillary. "Take it away and bury it." In London, the new Chancellor of the Exchequer, Mr. Kenneth Clark, was settling into his new job. "I had a bit of a heavy night last night," he told one of the nearby constables. "Can you remind me what job it is I'm supposed to be doing now? It's on the tip of my tongue. Well, if you don't seem to know, I'll just go back and ask my wife. Darling, what job is it I'm supposed to be doing again?" "Ah, Chancellor of the Exchequer, eh? Could be fun." The Queen attended the annual military ceremony of the bearing of the broth by the Royal Arbroath Broth Bearing Battalion. Bearing bulbous bowls of boiling beef broth, the Beef Broth Bearers Battalion of Arbroath swear to bear broth until their last breath. The Queen was visibly moved about 20 minutes later by car. The new blockbuster Steven Spielberg movie, Jurassic Park, starring talkative British film genius Lord Dickie Attenborough, had its royal premiere in London. The Princess of Wales arrived to be granted the supreme honour of being presented to Lord Dickie. It was a nerve-wracking moment for her, and she made the mistake of asking him a question. They all missed the movie while he answered. In Jurassic Park, dinosaurs come back to life.
How'd you do this?
Can I touch it?
Sure.
You feel that?
Hold on to your butt. This is a feeling all over the park.
Yeah, that's nice. Gotta go.
Look out! Down!
The sight of the dinosaurs had a shattering effect on such leading British intellectuals as Gloria Hunniford.
You cannot tell where the animatronics begin and end and where the real live dinosaurs are.
Australia's Danny Minogue, previously famous for singing bright, bouncy numbers with meaningless lyrics, took a dramatic step forward in her career and sang a bright, bouncy number with meaningless lyrics on a beach. It was called This Is It and This Is It. The first time this song was played on the public address system at Bondi Beach, a shark came ashore waving a white flag. Time for another category in our selection of Man or Woman of the Year for 1993. Which category is this, Louise?
This is the category for the year's Best Deputy. And it's there for all those people who stand behind the people who stand in front of the people.
And the nominees?
The first nominee is Bill Clinton.
The American husband, without whose willingness to smile encouragingly and do attractive things with his hair, Hillary Clinton would have had a far harder job running the country.
The second nominee is John Smith.
The Labour leader, without whose constant agreement, support and encouragement, John Major would have had a far harder job running the country.
The third nominee is Elizabeth Windsor.
The monarch without whose willingness to fade into the background, Lady Thatcher might never have become queen.
The fourth nominee is Lady Thatcher.
The monarch without whose willingness to fade into the background, God might have had a far harder job running the universe. And the winner, Louise?
The winner of the category for Best Deputy is Bill Clinton.
Sadly, Bill can't be with us tonight, but we're going live to Washington now to get the reaction from the most powerful leader in the world.
It is wonderful.
Thank you, Madam President. Bill Clinton's name now goes forward for the final selection of Man or Woman of the Year. More categories later, but for now, back to you, Clive, and on with the show.
In August, it was another birthday for the Queen Mother, and she was given a present the like of which she'd never seen before. She didn't know what it was before the curtain was lifted, and after the curtain was lifted, she still didn't know what it was. It was explained to her that it was a ceremonial gate. You could have fooled me, she said. A few wars ago, that was the sort of thing we used to melt down to make Spitfires. Call me old-fashioned, but I'd rather have a Nintendo Game Boy with some spare batteries. For being an all-round good egg, the Princess Royal was awarded a cup, which she accepted with her customary modest tact and good humour. Is that all I get, she asked. Which car boot sale did this come from? And what's he doing here? I suppose this was his idea. Can I go home now? Fashion. And the craze continued for the manufacturers of training shoes to pay stars big money for wearing their products. My new Reeboks comfort the soul and support my gothic arches, said Poland's most famous superstar. Football. And in Italy, Paul Gazza Gascoigne was out of the Lazio team with injury, but the club made an inspired decision. The Duchess of York was available, so they put her in as a replacement. With her hair tied back in a becoming ponytail, the Duchess joined the team in its rigorous training program. In her first practice session, she successfully maimed several teammates. She was many times heard to say, "This is much more fun than a weekend in Balmoral." British Wonder driver Nigel Mansell made a big impact in American IndyCar racing. He made an even bigger impact with his command of the English language, dazzling Americans with his eloquence when he was interviewed after his latest victory and asked whether the American public appreciated his subtle British use of wit, irony, understatement, and above all, brevity.
Well, I think at first it was with difficulty, but then they sort of came up to speed with myself and my sense of humour and the way I went to sort of do my job. And towards the end, it was just like a phenomenal experience that happened.
In the month's hit movie, In the Line of Fire, Clint Eastwood summoned up all his acting ability for an almost impossible task: to play an old man. He played an old Secret Service man in love with a younger Secret Service woman. Despite Clint's advanced age, she found him irresistible, and the two heavily armed secret agents finally succumbed to the eternal mystery. And the mystery was, why did he take his gun off and keep his vest and socks on? It was holiday time again for the royal corgis. They were off on their annual trip to Scotland, and when the Queen Mother went to the airport to see them off, she had a special message for the pilot. One of them's hungry enough to eat anything, she said, but I can't remember which one. The palace denied that one of the corgis ate the other on the way to Aberdeen. But our reporter counted them all on, and he counted them all off. This was the month that Buckingham Palace opened its doors to the public. The first week was a big success. But the second week was perhaps less satisfactory. The only visitor was one lone Frenchman. The tourist chose the cheap £2.50 mini tour, but the Queen herself personally turned up to graciously see him off the premises. Do come again, but next time bring a coachload of your girlfriends. We do group rates, she told him. I think I'd better go in and count the spoons, she added. Cindy Crawford released a video which showed women all over the world how to look like Cindy Crawford after a few simple exercises. Strangely enough, men liked the video too, although it contained nothing much except Cindy Crawford wearing not many clothes and jumping about. Our version of the video shows how Cindy's exercises caught on until everyone was doing them.
Here we are again, this time with a new workout. It's called The Next Challenge.
Bye. September, and in Britain, Conservative Party backbench rebels attempted to depose Prime Minister John Major by persuading him to sit in a specially constructed electric chair, which had been charged with 3,000 volts. First, they engaged Mr. Major in casual conversation, then they switched the chair on. But they had to put a brave face on it when they realized the fundamental flaw in their plan. The chair worked all right, but Mr. Major didn't notice. It was time for the most exciting cities in the world to bid for the Olympic Games in the year 2000. At the top of the list, it was a three-cornered fight between Beijing, Sydney, and Manchester. Manchester was the most glamorous, and it was hard to see how it could lose, especially when Britain's leading intellectuals put their weight behind the bid.
I think it's good. I think it's great that it'll come to Britain. You know, Manchester's part of that, so is Liverpool.
The spokesman for Beijing was equally effective. To everyone's surprise, both Manchester and Beijing lost out. Yes, Sydney got the games, and its citizens celebrated with all the quiet dignity for which they are renowned. Not all the merrymakers who fell into the harbour were eaten by sharks. Some were just too drunk to hold their breath. America and President Clinton, denying that his wife Hillary tells him what to do by sending him memos, called a press conference on the White House lawn to prove how few memos she had sent him. The aim was to prove that she'd sent him far fewer memos in the previous week than usual. Vice President Al Gore was there to show him Hillary's memo, in which Hillary told her husband to show her memos to the press to prove there were far fewer of them. Britain, and countering accusations of dithering, Prime Minister John Major reacted decisively to a letter from the ex-Chancellor of the Exchequer announcing his intention to have a sex change operation.
I'm rather sad that Norman should have written as he did, but that isn't I think it's rather sad and rather disingenuous.
Ex-Prime Minister Lady Thatcher published her memoirs. The book was a conspicuous example of her typical generosity of spirit. A special celebration rally took place so that those who had purchased the book could congratulate the author. Hundreds were there who were glad to spend £25 to secure a literary masterpiece, and one of them had actually read it. To celebrate her 30 years in show business, Diana Ross came to London to sign copies of her book. When she ran out of copies of her book, she signed copies of Lady Thatcher's book. When she accidentally read a page of Lady Thatcher's book, she ran out. When the Queen was in Australia, she had enjoyed a warm physical relationship with Australian Prime Minister Paul Keating. He had placed his hand affectionately on the royal person. It was now Mr. Keating's turn to visit Britain, where he was told that the Queen looked forward to meeting him again, and just for the occasion, she would be wearing a backless, strapless, one-piece bathing costume with platform shoes. The singing sensation of the month, and of every month in 1993, was a group called Take That.
Holding you right by my side. If the morning always comes too soon. Before I even close my eyes, yeah. All I do is shine and bang.
Teenage girls all over the country thought there could be nothing more blissful than to be on a tropical Far Eastern island with these creative young men. After hearing the record for the 100th time, their parents gave them the fare. In the Middle East, Israel and the Palestinians at last made peace. It was a triumph for PLO chief and beauty contest winner Yasmin Arafat. Finally, she could relax and take a holiday. Checking into a luxurious Gulf area hotel, Yasmin mistook the hotel doorman for the local sultan. The doorman said afterwards, "It was very nice, but I'd rather have had a tip." Yasmin was then shown to her room by the hotel manager. She told him she liked the chairs, but didn't like the wallpaper. Given a second room, she said she liked the wallpaper, but didn't like the chairs. Given a third room, she liked the wallpaper and the chairs, but didn't like the man who came to check the minibar. The annual conference of the British Labour Party produced a new hero, Mr. John Prescott. To an otherwise cold and bloodless occasion, he brought passion, his consuming passion for glamorous deputy leader, Margaret Beckett. "Lust overwhelmed me," he said later. "God, what a woman." Mr. Prescott wasn't alone in his admiration for Margaret Beckett. Labour Party leader John Smith had also been smitten by her charms, but managed to conceal his feelings as he joined her in singing "Auld Lang Syne." In line with the new cost-effective tax-paying monarchy, members of the royal family began travelling by underground between palaces. When a train broke down halfway to Windsor, several royals were led to safety through an access tunnel that came up somewhere near Shepherd's Bush. "I really enjoyed that," said the Queen Mother. "I didn't," said the Duke. "The Daimler for me next time," said Princess Margaret. "I just thought it was so marvellous we could all be together," said Prince Charles. Russia. And after facing a challenge from the Russian Parliament, President Boris Yeltsin easily won a vote of confidence by more than 300 tanks. He made a television commercial to show that his position was unchallenged and he was fully confident.
Учитывая многочисленные обращения в мой адрес, высокие субъекты Российской Федерации, групп депутатов, участников...
There was rejoicing in the streets of Moscow at Mr. Yeltsin's continuing success. High spirits prevailed at the annual convention of previous winners of the Miss Soviet Union competition. It had been a difficult time for Russia, but signs of growing prosperity silenced the critics. There still wasn't quite enough public transport, but people could always get on a bus if they really wanted to. Clint Eastwood was in London to promote one of his new films in which he opposes violence by confronting violent people and wiping them out. At a charity premiere, he formed an instant rapport with the Princess of Wales. "My granny told me she once met a very old woman who saw your first film," said the princess. Mr. Eastwood replied, "You just made my day, punk." In the year of receiving their bus passes, survivors of the 1960s were given the opportunity of purchasing a gramophone record featuring two of their old flames getting together and singing as if it were only yesterday that they stumbled out of Bieber wearing white plastic boots and lacquered beehives like motorcycle helmets. During the first screening of this video, several old admirers of Cilla and Dusty were taken to hospital after their attempts to do the hippie hippie shake dislocated their hip replacements. Time for another category in our selection of Man or Woman of the Year for 1993. And Louise, we must be close to announcing the overall winner by now.
Yes, Clive, but we still have one category to go, and that's the category for excellence in personal communication. It's open to those whose uncanny ability to express themselves with power and clarity leaves us shaking our heads in wonder.
And the nominees?
The first nominee is Nigel Mansell.
When he began to speak, they were hanging on his words. When he finished speaking, they were hanging from trees.
The second nominee is John Major.
When he began to speak, some members of the House of Commons fell asleep, and those who were already asleep died.
The third nominee is Sylvester Stallone.
When he began to speak, he was 27 years old.
And the fourth nominee is Lady Thatcher.
When she began to speak, somebody else was in the middle of a sentence. And the winner of this category, Louise?
The winner
of the category for excellence in personal communication is Nigel Mansell.
Sadly, Nigel can't be with us tonight. This isn't the first time he's been a finalist in our annual awards, so as we go live to him in Miami, I'm sure he'll have a sparkling speech ready on the tip of his silver tongue. How excited are you, Nigel?
I've been in the game a long time now, and I've been in this position before, and everybody thinks that emotions are running high, but, you know, I've been around a long time now, and I know exactly what's been going on, and I say the only thing I can say publicly, which I have done, is what I said on Sunday. I just said I stand by that, and that's all there is to it.
Thank you, Nigel Mansell. Clive, that completes our categories. Next time I return from our giant BBC computer, I'll have the final result of this year's Man or Woman of the Year contest.
The whole world's waiting, Louise.
Well, yes, Clive, except Libya, where Colonel Gaddafi has voted himself Man and Woman of the Year.
Ladies and gentlemen, Louise Lombard. October, and it was time for the Conservative Party conference. Deciding that slogans such as Forward to the Future lack flair, Prime Minister John Major personally devised an inspirational catchphrase to electrify the nation. A phrase as memorable as anything uttered by Winston Churchill. A phrase brilliantly calculated to stir the blood and fire the imagination.
Get your tractors off our lawn.
Within hours, the phrase, get your tractors off our lawn, was on everyone's lips. Mr. Major's awe-stricken colleagues stopped each other to speak reverently about their leader's newfound mastery of language. The government got tough with absentee fathers who were slow in paying maintenance to their abandoned wives and children. A government-sponsored video showed how a typical distressed single mother can apply to have her errant husband brought to account. All she has to do is fill in the appropriate forms, and then the full force of the law will be brought to bear against the sort of feckless man who moves around a lot, never settles to one job, and always has a reason for not handing over a paltry $10,000 a week. We'll get the cash out of him, says the friendly councillor, then we'll string him up for you. The Queen went to Cyprus to meet the Commonwealth leaders. Although the Queen had enjoyed her previous meetings with Australian Prime Minister Paul Keating, in which his hand had been placed affectionately on the royal person, it was decided that in the group photograph, Mr. Keating should be positioned at a sufficient distance from her so as to make use of his hand impossible. Is that your hand? The Queen asked the President of Cyprus. No, he told her, that's Keating's foot. The Queen set off on a tour of Cyprus. There was heavy opposition from the locals. It was decided that the Queen should return to Britain, and the royal tour of Cyprus was completed by sooty. Various disasters had befallen the marriages of the young royals, but hope sprang eternal for the marriage of Lord Linley and Serena Stanhope. Arriving for the ceremony, the Queen Mother was particularly excited. I've got £10 at Ladbrokes that says it won't last a year, she told herself. As the England football team, in its quest for the World Cup, moved steadily forward in a succession of triumphs for the opposing teams, Prime Minister John Major gave the England team his personal support.
They're a first-class team. They're steady under fire. They're united and they're serving Britain superbly.
With Mr. Major behind them, the England team's vital qualifying match against Holland could only end one way. But even with the prospect of elimination from the finals looming, the team could rely on Mr. Major's loyalty.
I think they're a disgrace, and I think they're an embarrassment to this country.
The popular singer Meat Loaf had a big hit with his song I Would Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That.
No, I won't do that. I would do anything for love, anything you've been dreaming of, but I just won't do that. I would do anything for love, anything you've been dreaming of, but
no, he wouldn't do that. And he wouldn't do that either. He would only do a bit of this, and that depended on those. As ever, Fleet Street knew all about what was going on in the marriage of the Prince and Princess of Wales. Diana will be divorced in 2 years, said the Sunday Express. On the other hand, the Sunday Express said, Diana wants a reconciliation. A man I met in the street with a model train running around the brim of his hat said, I think the Sunday Express has got it right. Talkative British film genius Lord Dicky Attenborough took his seat in the House of Lords but did not make a maiden speech. He told reporters, I shall make my maiden speech in January, February and March. There was bad news for Prime Minister John Major as polls showed his popular support had sunk to new depths. Mr. Kenneth Clark was being widely tipped as his successor. But when the possibility was put to Mr. Clark, he gravely denied any such ambition and was shocked and saddened by the very suggestion. In 1993, Japan's stature as an economic giant had grown to overwhelming proportions, and everyone in the West who could read the future was learning to speak Japanese. In the film Rising Sun, Sean Connery stunned Japanese cinema-goers when he spoke their language with supreme self-confidence. Yes, the Japanese were stunned because he had just ordered them to get their tractors off his lawn. With Christmas on the horizon, the Conservative Party were once again concerned about groups of young socialist carol singers prepared to sing carols for practically nothing instead of charging the market price. Some moderate Conservatives were ready to concede that the socialist carol singers might be allowed to sing after 9 o'clock at night, but a hard-line Tory Party spokesman disagreed.
Why 9 o'clock? Why 10 o'clock? Why 11 o'clock? Why midnight? Why not ban them all together?
November, and in America, First Lady Hillary Clinton instructed President Clinton to reinforce the US position in the Middle East by becoming more closely involved with Turkey. After the photo opportunity, the First Lady took the President aside, showed him the difference between a map of Turkey and a picture of a turkey, and then hit him with both of them. As the end of the year approached, surviving presidents of the United States assembled in the White House for a group photo opportunity. Observant television viewers noted that ex-president Ronald Reagan was absent. In fact, ex-president Reagan was in the White House at the time, but he was walking up and down in a broom cupboard saying, where are those other guys? Hit film of the month, the year, and for that matter the decade, was Walt Disney's Aladdin, which had everything, including lyrics almost as clever as those of the Pet Shop Boys and Meat Loaf. Take that, get this. Consternation once again for the British royal family when Princess Anne accidentally swapped handbags with the Queen and only found out in the middle of a public engagement that what she thought was a peppermint was in fact a Bob Martin's conditioning tablet for one of the royal corgis. in South Africa, there was a crisis in the church when Archbishop Desmond Tutu was asked what he will say when Michelle Pfeiffer carries out her threat to cover him from head to foot in raspberry ripple ice cream and lick it off.
I will say, yippee!
December, and United States foreign policy was under pressure in Somalia, Bosnia, Haiti, and almost everywhere else except Switzerland on a Sunday afternoon. But President Clinton and Vice President Al Gore still managed to stay in constant contact. What's the weather like where you are? Asked the President. 3:30 in the morning, replied the Vice President. Stay in touch, said the President. To celebrate her 30 years in show business, Diana Ross released the pop song of the month called Your Love. It was a good song and an outstanding video because for some reason it was all filmed at 45 degrees and you had to watch it sitting sideways.
And suddenly it's clear to me, without your love, where would I be? Your love has kept me going through good and bad times. It's kept me growing like a steady flame. Your love has kept
As the year roared towards a climax, Michael Jackson was under attack from all directions. The pressures of adverse publicity drove him into hiding. As the press searched for Michael Jackson all over the world, the most ludicrous rumors as to his whereabouts began to circulate. It was even suggested that he might have joined the Russian army as an anonymous recruit. It is a ridiculous suggestion, said a Russian army spokesman. If he tried to join our ranks, we'd have spotted him straight away. The Princess of Wales was facing the biggest ordeal of her public life, a meeting with Richard Branson. He lured her to a lonely aircraft hangar where he plied her with strong drink. Soon he was totally out of control and threw himself on her, hoarsely muttering, "I'm Richard, fly me." For the traumatized princess, it was the last straw. She announced her retirement from public life. Our Di was down, but was she out? Gloria Gaynor re-released a single which answered the question. About the only funny film of the year was called Adam's Family Values. All of it was good, and one scene had dramatic repercussions.
Gomez, Morticia, great news. Something impossible, a miracle.
The rash.
It's gone.
I'm engaged.
That ring.
It was our mother's. She was buried with it.
Yes, Prince Edward saw the film and decided that if Uncle Fester could find love, so could he. The world was rocked by the news that yet another royal child had embarked on the frail vessel of romance. The prince and Miss Sophie Rhys-Jones had apparently been canoodling for some time. Would there be more of the same to come? A Downing Street marriage guidance expert was in no doubt.
Over the next few weeks and months, there may be bumping and grinding.
In the United States, there was romance in the air. It was claimed that there had been other women in President Clinton's life. The sensational news was broken to Hillary Clinton with shocking effect. The year 1993 was drawing to a close with a glorious burst of human achievement. Up in space, the Hubble satellite telescope was adjusted to receive the first message from other life forms at the edge of the universe. From across thousands of light years, from an alien mentality unimaginably more advanced than ours, came the eloquent message that would inspire all of mankind.
Get your tractors off.
And now, as Big Ben winds itself up for the big strike, it's time for the result of this year's new improved competition for Man or Woman of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, Louise Lombard. Do you have the result, Louise?
Yes, Clive. It was very close, but just before our giant BBC computer exploded, it gave us the names of the winner and the runners-up.
Then please announce them for us in reverse order.
In third place, it's Bill Clinton.
Sadly, as we said, Bill can't be with us tonight. But as we go live by satellite to Washington, I know he'll say that without his wife Hillary planning his every move, he would never have won this nomination.
Hillary played no role in this nomination or this decision. And so deserves no blame or credit for
it. Hillary must have told him to say that. And in second place, Louise?
In second place, it's Nigel Mansell.
Sadly, as we said, Nigel can't be with us tonight, but we all know it wasn't just his driving that thrilled the world, it was also his eloquence. Let's go back by satellite to Miami as he hears the news and makes one of those scintillating speeches that thrill us to the marrow. Nigel, how do you feel knowing that you and the other runners-up have just missed out on the big prize?
I feel for them, and I know they feel for me, and I think we share the same feelings and disappointments, because they know that we'd like to have defended it. But, that's life, I'm afraid.
Thank you, Nigel. Louise, this is the big moment. First, tell us, is it a man or a woman of the year?
Well, Clive, the computer has been counting votes from all over the world, and it tells us that this time we have a woman of the year.
And there's only one woman it could be. She's been in every category. She's in all our lives. She's on all our bookshelves. And she is...
Yes, Clive. She is, of course, Diana Ross.
Sadly, Diana can't be with us tonight, but of course we've...
I have a surprise for you. Ladies and gentlemen, Diana Ross!
Diana, in my life, you're the woman of the year every year.
Well, thank you very much, Clive.
Louise, would you do the honours with the honour?
Diana, congratulations on winning Woman of the Year 1993. Why, thank you.
Thank you so much.
This is a wonderful way to start 1994. Thank you.
Well, it hasn't quite started yet, Diana, and just before it does, will you sing us one of your marvelous songs to finish 1993 on a high note?